also brings you the power of a new world in Scientific American Frontiers.
You really have to move around on the tennis court. I'm just about keeping up with my opponent. A remarkable young man named Hugh Hearn. 10 years ago, Hugh lost his legs in a dramatic accident. Good. Great shot.
Well, how did you get to this point? What do you want? This was a mountain climbing accident.
Yes. In 1982, I went to New Hampshire to climb Mount Washington in the winter. And after climbing a 1,000-foot ice face, it was a tremendous storm. We got disoriented near the summit. Blizzard conditions. You and I wouldn't even be able to see each other. It was a tremendous way out. Make a long story short, a day outing turned into 4 days. The conditions were minus 20 degree temperatures. We didn't have a sleeping bag, a tent, no food.
They were completely exposed for 4 days.
That's right. And to survive, we dug into the snow. And my partner and I just hugged each other to stay warm. From that, I got tremendous frostbite. Lower leg. And after 2 months in the hospital, they had to be amputated.
Hugh had led an adventurous life and was now in full. But he was determined to stay active. He decided to become an engineer and dream of ways for people to use their bodies for maximum efficiency. And he found inspiration.
Sense a device that makes human beings more powerful. Clearly, if I were to try to throw an arrow with my bare hands, I would not be able to pierce the target. But with the elastic bow, I can easily pierce the target. So it makes human beings more powerful in a sense.
The secret of the bow and arrow is that a normal person can build up tremendous energy in its powerful spring. Right now, Hugh's wife, Lee, can't do pull-ups. But watch this. She's wearing a special spring suit designed by Hugh. As she reaches up, her pushing muscles build up energy in 2 bungee cords. Then the cords help her pulling muscles get her over the bar. It was Hugh's accident that set him thinking about how technology can overcome disabilities.
Was that the motivation for your developing these devices?
I quickly realized that there's no such thing as a handicapped, physically disabled person. There are only physically disabled technologies. If I have the correct legs and whatnot, I can run a marathon. I can run a marathon.
Hugh returned to climbing years ago using an artificial leg of his own design. Twice as far before getting done.
nice rubber soles and got air in there.
When you say high class.
Well, I don't know. They are classy. Well, I mean, it's very technological issue, you know. I want to know why this doesn't store energy as well as your spring. I mean, doesn't this rubber collect energy and then give it off again? Doesn't it contract and expand?
It does, but the problem is the materials being used here are not very efficient as far as being efficient springs. When you compress the sole of a shoe, yes, it does store some energy, but it doesn't store a lot of the energy. The problem is you put a unit of energy in, you don't get a unit out.
Where does it go?
There's a heat loss. The sole of your shoe just heats up. It's running mile to mile to mile.
To develop his shoe springs, Hugh turned to one of nature's best runners. Horses have natural springs built right into their legs. Springs are actually elastic ligaments that run up and down the leg. When the hoof is in the air, these springs are relaxed. Then as the horse's weight drives into the ground, the spring bends and stretches and stores up energy. Ligament for human shoes.
When it hits the ground,
it takes a lot of pressure.
But yeah,
but it's still when you're actually wearing it, it's fairly soft.
When the runner comes and strikes the surface with the ground,
with the heel.
Right, this heel spring collapses and stores energy. And then as the runner's foot rolls over to the forefoot region, that enables this spring to open up. It's like a hand on the bottom of the heel thrusting, pushing the heel up. And that energy in turn enables the foot to bend this second spring. And then the second spring in turn helps the runner thrust forward to get this energy pop at the end. So effectively what the runner feels with this shoe is a nice cushion upon impact. And then at the very end, an energy pop.
Early in the design process, Hugh and his partner tried to sell the idea to major American sneaker companies.
The heel spring here is compressed.
Using a crude steel mock-up, they explained how the energy-efficient sole was supposed to work. But the marketing experts and engineers were universally unimpressed.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. We'll be in touch. Thank you.
One by one, the companies turned them down. Eventually, a Japanese company agreed to fund their research, providing sneakers and enough money to hire an expert in carbon fibers. Working with thin sheets of this space-age material, he made a series of strong, lightweight working prototypes. In the first batch, the spring was simply slid into the middle of off-the-shelf sneakers. The whole sandwich held together with glue. Using student volunteers.
What I want you to do is just run onto the path. I want you to run normally. Don't do anything. I want you over there.
The task was to run over this force plate, which can measure how much energy goes into the ground or shoe and how much gets returned to the runner.
All right, Rich, I want you to run through again, except this time, increase your speed a bit.
Shows the force and impact was consistently low, meaning the spring sole was absorbing most of the shock. And a high rating at liftoff showed the sneaker was returning that energy to push the runner forward. In contrast, the most popular brand let the runner feel more shock and gave less push at the end. So, at least in the lab, the spring sole looks like a winner.
But you try it. It's great. It'll be up to him ready for Atlanta.
But this is a more critical test. Whether the spring sole can really make runners go faster. Michael Connor is the editor of Running Magazine. Bobby Fischer is a respected amateur. And the third test runner is Kenyan-born Steve Coco, a star 1 kilometer performer. They'll be competing not against each other, but against their own best times on this particular track.
I feel great. I feel like I have more energy already. I'm going to wear these to work today.
On your mark, get set, go!
They'll do a 400-meter lap, so in just over a minute, you and your partner will know their invention is all they've designed for.
I normally would do it about 83 seconds. I was 74 seconds.
Oh, yes. Bobby, that away. All right.
I didn't feel it in my legs. It was great.
Normally, when I'm running repeat 400 meters, I'm running in between 75, about 75 seconds. Today, I was 71.8. So that's a significant improvement with the same effort. You know, yeah, I think you guys are onto it. It's really, really feels good.
Get around the corner and get to those short bullets.
That's right.
I'll send you a bouquet. I'm just going to go take a little walk with this.
How are they?
You know, it's great. I'll let you one for these right now.
I'll send you barrels then.
Great. You know what they're really good for?
What?
When the game is over. This should make this part easy.
All right, that easy.
Work on that part, will you?
With springs, we can become stronger, more powerful. We can have greater endurance. I think this is the age of spring. I don't think it's been done yet. You know, I can think of about 100 different devices that I can put springs into. So, I'm not finished yet.
Someone whose baseball experience is an occasional game in softball.
You learn how to hold it?
No, I'm just working on the scene part. Okay. I'll get the arm later. I don't want to do it all at once. I'm going to throw my brain. Why don't you throw the ball and show me one of those? Jim Palmer once pitched a no-hitter for the Baltimore Orioles, a game caught by Elrod Hendricks, who is now an Orioles coach. Great pitchers have an arsenal of different pitches. There's the curveball.
Better than I made my comeback. I think we started something here.
Curveballs start high, but then drop down. And of course, the fastball hardly seems to drop at all.
What happens to the ball after it leaves your hand in a fastball?
Well, you hope it goes up to the catcher and does a good hit. But, you know, I mean, basically, what happens when that ball comes out of your hand, it's going to have backspin. The ball's actually going to hit the air, and hopefully, it'll have a little bit of movement.
Backspin that keeps fastballs up, and the opposite, topspin, that makes curveballs drop. Batters have to start their swing before the ball's even halfway to the plate, and by then they must have decided just when and where the ball will arrive. Yet the average pitch is all over in half a second.
You have a split second to make all the decision, and then to have a good swing at it and make good contact, and making good contact out in front of the home plate, and then finding a home.
Put like that, it's amazing anybody can hit.
ready?
No, I just want to get it.
Look, watch out, because I don't want to hurt you, fellas.
But how could I resist one day being able to tell my grandchildren of the time I faced Jim Palmer?
That was a strike.
Yes.
Oh. Well, if you're going to curve it like that, what chance do I have? I touched it.
Right.
Okay, don't get upset. I was just. I didn't really need to touch the ball. Now he's mad. I only face a softball about once every 5 years. I'm amazed to find myself standing at all. What interests me is how hard it is to hit the ball. Not just for me. That's expected. But a professional baseball player, on average, only gets a successful hit about once every four times. Maybe the only profession where you can fail three quarters of the time and be successful.
But now, help is arriving for the believer in batter, a very unlikely player.
Speaking of ladies and gentlemen, it's my supplier, Carl Benjamin. All these are things I have a project.
Retired Ohio school teacher John Garber is the history of sports inventions. Many haven't made it out of his junkyard. The first large hit tennis racket, now common in the sport, was built right here. 30 years ago, he invented an air-driven gun that throws baseballs. Unlike most pitching machines, this one can quickly switch from throwing curveballs to fastballs. Many teams bought one. Batters wouldn't use them because they were too hard to hit against. The problem, Garber decided, wasn't his machine, but that batters simply didn't know how to hit.
And it took me 10 years to find out what was behind that. 10 years. Then another 20 years trying to convince people I found it out.
Garber is now trying to sell his secret to ball teams. At first, his only success was with little coaches. But today, he's been invited to test his idea. Many of Kent State's players go into the major leagues, yet their hitting needs all the help it can get. Head coach Danny Hall.
I think that probably the majority of guys that are hitting, whether it's guys that I'm getting in a college program or whether it's guys that are playing professional baseball, have no idea what they're doing, whether it's mentally, physically, what have you. I don't think they understand what is going on when they're trying to hit.
To show batters how little they know, Garber begins his two-day program with one of his typical homemade contraptions. The task is to hit line drives.
And what you smack is hard. The rules are, it's a good ball. If it clears the infield dirt, it's above the ground.
Line drives give batters the best chance of getting on base. And when the ball is in the middle of the strike zone, there's no problem. In slow motion, you can see the bat meets the ball dead center. But now, Garber repositions the balls to the top and the bottom of the strike zone.
Now, let's see if that low one counts. Walk up to it. Well, the umpire I know called that strike. Okay.
Ground balls are usually outs.
That sound of grass on the ball almost makes you sick, though.
And pop-ups are usually caught.
I was very surprised because I watched the first guy do it and I couldn't believe it wasn't in a mile high. And I get in there and do it. I couldn't adjust. When it's not moving and you can't hit it, how are you going to hit it when it's moving?
The slow motion reveals what's happening. Batters aren't hitting for the rhythm. Raising the top of the level, blocking the down. Raising the bottom of the high level, blocking them up. So Garber offers some radical advice.
Pitch from the high ball is to swing them up. That would be to pass center of the bat, perhaps, across the top of the ball. And if we raise the ball up a little higher, you might have to miss the ball altogether. The fix in the low zone was to pass the bat below the ball. So you clean missed it. Try to do that, and you'll make contact, solid contact.
Well, it sounds strange, first of all, because you know, you're always taught to hit the ball
in the center of the ball, and to actually sit there and try to actually miss the ball, knowing that your mind's thinking it's going to miss, it's something new.
Yeah, I got this one.
All the players are skeptical, but having hit so poorly when they aim to hit, now they try aiming to miss.
Hot dig. That's the first time for one of those, huh?
On the replay, the bat makes solid contact with the center of the ball, even though the batter was aiming below it. Next, a high ball.
Well, I swing, I'm aiming somewhere about right.
Okay.
Connection there. Okay, a little adjustment on this one. A little bit lower. Lower. There they are.
The players are impressed.
Definitely makes it easier. Just by hitting the ball on a wide drive, then popping it up and down the ground.
Look at that.
I'm applying science to what's going on, not happenchance observation. And if we can't establish that the thing we're seeing is true and repeatable, then I'm just a baloney guy, not worth listening to. If we can establish it, then the science tells us you better pay attention.
Now it's time for Garver to demonstrate another embarrassing weakness of the average batter.
Here we go with forcing fastball.
How their judgment is confused when pitchers change pitches on them.
Ah, where's his hand and where's the ball?
Batters must point to where they think the ball has hit the canvas.
Ready? Ready?
They're only allowed to see the ball up to the halfway point, which is when they'd have to commit to a swing if they were actually hitting.
Okay. Ready?
This player judged a fastball right on the money. But watch what happens when Garver quickly switches to a curveball.
Ready? Oh, was he really fooled with that one?
On the replay, the error is dramatic.
He just missed the curveball by over a foot. But he had seen fastballs beforehand. That set him up not to be able to identify it. It always does that. Whatever the changed pitch is, causes you to miss identifying the new pitch and seriously makes you misjudge it.
Garber believes the misjudgment can be minimized by pausing between pitches, an idea being tested on the simulator where the light is the ball, the slider, the pitch. As the pitch flashes down the track, the bat should pass the white line just as the last ball flags up. Accuracy is poor.
You were early by 167 milliseconds.
But with nearly every batter tested, when the time between pitches is greater than 15 seconds, judgment improves.
You were early by 1 millisecond. No matter how far. If batters are facing a pitcher who is throwing quickly between pitches, in other words, not taking very much time, and there are some, for example, major league pitchers who are well known for that, the batter would be wise to call timeout, step out of the box, delay probably somewhere on the order of 15 seconds at least in terms of the time between the pitches to lessen the potential effect of the pitcher changing speeds.
After 2 days of training in Garver's out games, it's time to try them out in practice games. About the odd notion of aiming to miss. Player number 9 was in Garver's class, and today at least, aiming below low balls and above high balls seems to be working.
Sometimes it's hard to think about as you're doing it, but on a couple of them I did think about it, and I actually swung hard at it, and I hit the ball well.
And number 22, after missing a ball, takes advantage of Garver's research and tries a 15-second breather. This helps him erase from his mind any memory of the previous pitch. He'll face
Translated into the ball game, if you can make a guy make twice as many contacts, you could possibly double his batting average.
Now, if you can get a hit three out of 10 times, you can make a Hall of Fame. So if you can get that up to 4,
but the real test of Gardner's claim to be applying science to the art of hitting will take more than a practice game. Keep an eye on Kent State next season. Peter Berge is looking for a way to predict who will get high-altitude illness. Here in Heidelberg, Germany, he's recruited some volunteers willing to push their bodies to the limit to help find a test that will tell people before they climb if they're likely to get sick. This is Art. His testing begins by finding out how fit he is. As he works harder, his body responds by increasing his heart rate, pumping more blood to his muscles and so supplying them with more oxygen to burn. And to get that extra oxygen into his blood, he breathes faster and more deeply. Now the real test begins. Art's oxygen is cut back, simulating high altitude. The idea is to see how he responds when there is less oxygen available. Again, his heart rate increases, and again his breathing gets faster and deeper. At the equivalent of 15,000 feet, Art is breathing 5 times more air than usual, even at rest. This is Michael, another of Peter Berge's human guinea pigs. On the fitness test, he's as good as Art. But when Michael's oxygen is reduced, there's a curious difference. At a simulated 15,000 feet, Michael's breathing is little different from what it was at normal altitude. Even during moderate exercise, his body, unlike Art's, seems to be ignoring the fact that his oxygen supply is dropping. Peter Baerge wondered if people like Michael, whose bodies don't seem to recognize they're getting into trouble when oxygen is scarce, might be the ones most susceptible to mountain sickness. There was one way to find out. It perched at 15,000 feet on the Italian-Swiss border. It's the perfect laboratory. A 100-year-old mountain hut, the highest building in Europe. Peter Baerge is heading there now. And because he is himself susceptible to mountain sickness, he's taking it slowly, giving his body time to acclimate. But the subjects in this experiment don't have that luxury. They climb fast, rising 2 miles in elevation in just over a day. The experiment is designed so that neither Baerge nor his subjects know how they perform in their tests. So Art, for instance, doesn't know that his test suggested he'd cope with the mountain air by breathing much harder. Makes regular checks. At 5:30 a.m., the only one complaining is Udo. Neither Udo nor Baerge knows that his test predicted his breathing should adjust to the altitude. But if it has adjusted, it hasn't been enough to prevent his worsening symptoms. The critical question is whether he's getting enough oxygen into his blood. And when a sample is analyzed, it reveals a blood oxygen level only half what it should be. Baerge suspects Udo is developing pulmonary edema, fluid in the lungs hampering their ability to absorb oxygen from the air. Because it's been caught early, the problem can be alleviated with drugs. Art, meanwhile, as predicted, is still doing fine. His balance is good, his blood oxygen normal.
He would love to climb the difference between Sarah and the other mountain. I think he's actually enjoying himself, and it's my impression.
which leaves Michael, who was definitely not enjoying himself. His pre-climb test suggested he wouldn't adjust his breathing to the altitude, and he is now very sick.
The problem with him was he didn't call us last night when he went to bed. He already realized that something was wrong, and no one called us. And then I saw him this morning. He was really in a serious condition. I think if we had called him earlier, we could have stopped the process at an early level.
Michael's decision to tough out the night could have been a fatal error.
I didn't know this place was getting worse and worse. So I just in the morning at 5:30, they wake me up and I couldn't do anything.
You couldn't breathe, you had trouble breathing, you didn't feel like you couldn't breathe either.
Yeah, I couldn't breathe, I couldn't walk, I couldn't stand.
X-rays show Michael has advanced pulmonary edema. The lace-like pattern in his lungs, especially on the right, is the accumulating fluid.
This means that we have a very severe illness. If we do not treat Michael, he's most likely going to die. Fluid will accumulate in all his lung, and he will eventually drown. And we have to immediately install treatment by giving oxygen now and fly him down as soon as possible.
The oxygen will stabilize Michael's condition for a while, but the only way to clear the fluid from his lungs is to get him off the mountain fast. A rescue helicopter was called in from Zermatt, Switzerland. Turns out the breathing test Peter Bear chose might have. sailboats which plow through the water. A plainy windsurfer just skips across the surface. That's why most people are convinced windsurfers will always be the fastest sail-powered watercraft. The Great Kettle from Long Beach, California, thinks windsurfers have had their day.
The windsurfers have been going up steadily since 86, just bit by bit, little tiny refinements, and so it doesn't seem likely that they're going to get all of a sudden go considerably faster.
Greg is sailing with Trifoil, a radical hydrofoil boat designed for self-propelled dolphin pilots, to snatch the speed record away from the windsurfers. But Greg isn't the only one with this goal. On the other side of the world, Australian Lindsay Cunningham is after VLAC's record too. He's also come up with a radically different design. His boat, Endeavour, uses a solid wing sail mounted on three small planing holes.
Hey,
Lindsay and Greg are arch rivals in the world of speed sail. Both won VLAC's record, and both think that their sail technology can prevail over the windsurfer's physical advantage. Greg has pinned his hopes on hydrofoils, small wings that work like airplane wings.
Everything that the airplane designers do, we do just about the exact same thing. The big difference is water is about 700 times more dense than air, so our wings are 700 times smaller than the airplane wing.
As the boat speeds up, the foils produce lift, just like an airplane, raising the hulls off the surface. With only the streamlined foils slicing through the water, Greg's trifoiler should be as efficient as a planing windsurfer. The major drawback of hydrofoils is that it's hard to keep the boat at a constant height above the water. But here's where Greg has made a breakthrough. He's found a way to keep his hydrofoil stable. It works like this. The two skis extending from the outside hulls act like feelers, sensing the boat's height above the water. If a hull lifts up, the ski drops, lifting the hull downward. This automatically tips the foil down. Now the water is pushing down on the angled foil, forcing the hull downward. On the other hand, if a hull drops down, system seems to be working. But down in Australia, Lindsay Cunningham decided hydrofoils were too risky.
We do the planning work on the sailboards, and we got involved with having a lot of control problems. And the way they're efficient in themselves, their overall efficiency was still wasn't that good.
Taking his cue from windsurfers, Lindsay made Endeavour's pontoon-like hulls flat on the bottom, so they can plane easily. And to reduce drag even further, Lindsay designed the boat to sail on only two of the three hulls. The crew sits in a capsule on the longest arm of the tripod. Helmsman Simon McCown faces forward to steer. Facing sideways, Tim Dotto works the sail. Just enough for the crew pod to lift free of the water. It's a delicate balance here. Tightening too much may drive the boat faster, but could flip it over. Too little, and the pod drops in the water. But with the pod flying in the individual hull's plane, Endeavour, like Greg's trifoiler, can match a windsurfer's performance. Still no designs perfect. The drawback of Lindsay's solution was the terrific strain created as the weight of the crew fights the force of the wind. Last year, in the middle of a run, that strain resulted in disaster.
I think what
at the wrong moment and cause the boat to really basically go up into the water at quite a high speed. But fortunately, the cockpit is designed to let us out when a disaster like that happens, and we just somersault it over the water a few times.
While Lindsay Cunningham's boat was out of action for repairs, Greg Ketterman was hard at work. During these speed trials off the coast of Africa, he came tantalizingly close to Beeline's record. Close, but not quite.
Right now, we seem to be hitting the wall right at about 50 miles per hour.
The faster the boat goes, the harder it is to drive. And it reaches a limit, regardless of how hard the wind blows. Show what's going on with Greg's foil as the water speed approaches the mysterious wall.
Okay, speed's coming up a little more.
As we passed through 40 miles an hour, we saw what Greg had long suspected.
There's some cavitation. Just starting.
Streams of bubbles began to appear under the foil. It's called cavitation.
What's the speed? It's about 43 miles an hour.
So, you want to inch up closer to the speed at which you experience the fall?
Yeah, let's go slowly. Go faster, no.
As we approached 50 miles an hour, the foil became covered in a sheet of foam. This is what Greg's boat has to pull along with it.
Pressure goes so low that the water vaporizes or boils.
So you're looking at a kind of boiling there.
Yeah.
Cavitation creates a lot of drag. It's like a big underwater break. Greg had suspected it might be happening, but until now, he hadn't known for sure.
Well, that seems to explain exactly what our problem is. So that confirms your hypothesis that cavitation is the source of the drag.
Yeah.
Out there underwater, you're going as fast as you can to hit that wall at 50 some miles an hour, and you're thinking that under the water this is happening. Now you've seen it for the first time. That must be an interesting experience.
It's super exciting. This is what I wanted to say, because we want the record, and we need to simply change the shape as a real simple fix.
Now Greg can concentrate on redesigning his foils, rather than tinkering with other elements. Like the sails, which are probably working fine. But in the very week Greg and I were at MIT, Greg's big rivals down under, waiting for the wind in this bay south of Melbourne. Lindsay Cunningham's Endeavour is fully repaired and back in action. Perfect weather is forecast, with high winds sweeping down the wide beach onto the bay. 500-meter course is set up close to the beach where the smoothest water will be. The blue wind shelters are cameras and official timers. Simon and Tim made several calls, but the wind is gusting. We've seen Tim struggling to keep the pod flying.
Suddenly,
only sail in one direction. Endeavor is dragged back to the start. It's another in a long line of frustrating runs. And now the wind is rising ominously with an approaching storm. Nobody wants a repeat of last year's disaster. Lindsay decides they can get in one more run.
Massachusetts, 02172. Please be sure to specify which episode you'd like.
This is PBS.
Free teaching materials to accompany Scientific American Frontiers are available from Connecticut Public Television. Educators only may call 1-800-523-5948.